Hello and welcome to the Engineer Innovation Podcast. With me today is a returning guest who's Justin Hodges. How are you doing, Justin?
Great. Excellent. I love talking about AI and it's always fun to chat with you.
Last time you were on the podcast, I think it was probably April. I think the episode came out in June as well. And I started that interview. I was trying to be provocative and I was going to try, you were on with Remy Duquette, who's another expert in AI. And I was trying to be provocative and I was going to say, you know, what do you think about ChatGPT? Thinking that you were going to be dismissing it as a toy. But since then, I think the whole world has gone crazy with generative AI, with large language models. And on this podcast, what we wanted to do, I think, is start off, we'll have a chat about generative AI and what the current state of it is. But then in the second half of it, you're going to go through some real life examples, because I think there's only so much talking we can do about these things. And what we want to do is we want to encourage engineers to do some proper generative AI, practical AI themselves. And so we're going to have some kind of code along examples where people can follow what you're doing and do something productive and practical straight after or during this podcast. Does that sound like a plan, Justin?
We'll go through an example that you can replicate on a different screen with the podcast on one screen and Python or SimCenter Studio on a separate screen. I made the example such that you don't need to wait on me or request any files. You can just code along. And like you said, it'll cover the basics.
We've mentioned the words generative AI, and this whole topic moves so quickly. It can be quite exhausting. Can you just explain for people listening who don't know what generative AI means to you?
To make things, right? I guess that's the simplest way. But at its core, it's learning from vast amounts of data, and it's generating very complex, high-fidelity models with minimal human intervention. And when I say make things, you know, you've seen examples of ChatGPT, so it's predicting and generating the next words and conversation. You've seen probably what feels like forever ago now with DALL-E, where it could produce images based on text. So you could say, you know, make a picture of a bunny jumping, you know, on the back of a dog, and then it'll make a picture for you and generate that for you. But it's really just simple examples there. It could be music, editing tools, social media content, apps, things like that. So really the purpose is about creating. And one fine point coming from CAE, mechanical engineering, aerospace, etc., is, you know, a lot of the times we focus on fitting a model to our data. And that simple exercise of saying, I have this data, please fit a model, wouldn't quite qualify as generative AI or generative engineering. However, you can do a lot with those models. And in that case, you can use them in generative AI contexts where you actually do produce things like, what's the best design? Please tell me what the geometry should look like or what my flow field should look like, stuff like that.
Or helping you to write code as well, which is what I've been using it for, is like, I'm a 50-year-old guy, kind of Fortran 77 generation. I like to play around in Python, but I'm a rotten Python programmer. And so what I've been playing around with ChatGPT on is helping it to write Python code to solve some quite complicated problems. And like, you know, in terms of productivity, my productivity as an engineer and a programmer, I'm going to say it's at least five times, but I'm doing things that I didn't think I'd be able to do. Because instead of, you know, looking at Google, trying to figure out how to debug my code, how to work with a new library, what I'm doing is I sit down with ChatGPT, I describe the problem that I'm trying to solve, and you have to tell it not to write any code to start with while you're still, you know, kind of describing the problem, and we have a conversation about the problem that I'm trying to solve, and then it helps me write the code. And you know, I've on like four or five different projects which I've managed to solve in the last couple of months, you know, which I've been thinking about for years. ChatGPT is writing almost all of the code for me. I literally don't have to write a single line of code. Quite often, you know, it will make mistakes. So if you use the code interpreter version of ChatGPT, it's quite funny because you can see it making mistakes constantly, running the code itself in the background and fixing mistakes. So it will make mistakes and we'll work through those mistakes together. You know, I'll run the code, it won't work, I'll tell it what the errors are and it will debug the code. But I've got to some really, really interesting places with it, and I'm just completely inspired by it. Yeah, it's really, really changed the way I think about engineering.
Yeah, me too. There's two quotes I'll give, one silly, one less silly. One's from Elon Musk years before ChatGPT, and he's just talking about technology and cell phones, and he basically said, we're turning into cyborgs, right? Because with this little thing in your possession, you're vastly more capable. And I think that this is a natural extension to continue that. And then the other one, I don't remember what learning resource it was, but one of the online classes on generative AI, in kind of the opening preamble, they gave a really nice quote that I wrote down. It said, for applications of generative AI, lifting the dirty, dull, dangerous, and difficult tasks from humanity's shoulders so we can simply focus on the very essence of our work, the vision, the idea, and the purpose. And I think that's spot on, right? I think that that's really what you just kind of said. There's a lot of stuff there that could take up the time and give you more time to focus on the vision, the idea, and the purpose.
Let's be honest as well, as simulation engineers, yeah, lots of what you have to do is dull and dirty, isn't it? You know, building meshes, tuning under relaxation parameters, there are still dirty bits that you don't want to do. And really what you're interested in is getting some data out and using that data to inform decisions as well. So anything you can do to kind of automate that and take the heavy lifting out of it, I think is really useful. And I think that's the point about AI. Plus, people are threatened by AI, and you hear lots of conversations. We've had conversations, this is going to be the end of engineers. But the truth of it is there's not enough engineers in the world. Yeah, there's not enough of us. There's not enough engineering simulation in the world. And this is just helping us all to be many times more productive. My other observation as well is that, you know, this, I've been using it for Python. Like when I first started doing CFD 30 years ago, everything was on a command line. And so we had to learn the language of the CFD code, you know, C set, new set, V set. And I got really good at that. And for the first 10 years of my career, I was that guy typing in command lines, you know, no point and click user interfaces. But people didn't want to do that. That went away and people started using point and click user interfaces because that was easier. But actually, you know, the way we interact with each other is through language, isn't it? And what, instead of learning language of the computer or learning how to use an interface, what I want to do is I want to tell the computer in English or whatever language you speak, how to do what I ask it to do, the things that I want it to do. And for me, that really is a big part of the future of engineering simulations, having these conversations with an AI assistant that helps you implement things. I found quite often that when I've got stuck with ChatGPT, and I've asked it to do things and it can't do it. The problem is me usually. It's because I've asked the wrong questions, you know, and I've gone away and I've researched a topic and asked the questions in the proper way. And then ChatGPT comes back with some really good stuff as well. So I think there's definitely a role for us. And I think it can make everybody more intelligent, I think. Yeah, that's what artificial intelligence is doing, and more productive.
Yeah. Gosh, there's so many thoughts. One is what was interesting, maybe like 10 years ago, I was at a energy and turbo machinery conference, and the keynote speaker was from a guy that owned essentially, or was in charge of essentially, a large like energy power plant grid management sort of company. And in his keynote, the first thing he said was, what's the most transformative thing in our industry that we should talk about for the next few years? He said the iPhone. Unrelated, right? But it completely changed the paradigm on how people expect to do their work, get their information, do their analysis, communicate, and the speed at which they do such. And I think that's a bigger gap when you hear iPhone and energy management, right? Versus like generative AI and the way that we use our software. But I think it's the same sort of paradigm shift, right? The reality is no one would buy software if it was limited to using command line now. And I think that will continually change more and more. And you can't help but appreciate some of the cross-pollination from the mainstream generative AI that you see, where now you can make apps in ridiculously fast amounts of time, exchange information, exchange models from different places and use them like freely and in an open source way. So that's one thing I would definitely say is a staple here in what's at play is this paradigm shift. And the other point you touched on is cool, because as far as like we're going to have to learn and change things and adapt to build up, people always say, how can we trust AI? How can we trust generative AI? And I think there's probably like three or four main things to talk about there. But one of them is controllability education, right? I think we have the responsibility to promote responsible and ethical use, and that really relies on us. That means we have to understand limitations, best practices, and stuff like that. And I think it's cool now because you can ask anyone really who's used ChatGPT to look at a few different prompts, and they can probably reason out which one's the older model, which one's the new model. And so you already see people getting a really nuanced understanding of like what the models do and don't do. So yeah, it's a freight train, but it's going in a good direction.
So, and I agree completely, but I think in order to do that, one of the first things you do is you have to stick your toe into the water and start using it. And I think as engineers, we're quite good at getting new technology and pushing all the buttons and trying to break it as well. So it's about having some practical experience as well. And so on the last podcast, I asked you what some things people could do in order to start using AI and ML. And you suggested Kaggle as like this library of competitions as well. And so last week sometime, I found myself browsing through that, found the competition on digital image recognition, so recognizing numbers that are written down, and there's a competition on that, a competition on there to, you know, to do that. You know, you can choose whatever technology you choose, but you know, I go into ChatGPT, work at how to import the data, ask ChatGPT how I would write a neural network, write a neural network, start playing with a neural network. And the important bit is like ChatGPT is not doing that playing. It's me trying to tune the hyperparameters to get good results. You know, getting up to 96% recognition, which is, I think, top 1,300 in the competition. And then going back to ChatGPT and saying, how can I get better? And it says, you should try a convolutional neural network. So downloading one of those, implementing that, playing around a bit, and then suddenly like, I'm at 98.5% recognition, top 600 in the competition, and I've done all this, not understanding neural networks very much, not being a great Python programmer, but managed to do this in an evening, actually doing it in bed, which is a bad idea because I can never ever sleep when I do these things. But I think things like neural networks, and we're going to talk a bit in a minute about different types of machine learning models, they sound really intimidating because you think, you know, ChatGPT's got billions of parameters and like, can I do anything on my computer? But absolutely, you can write a simple neural network. You could be up and running inside an hour. You know, you might not understand all of it, and you might not be an expert in it, but you can get running and get experimenting. I think that's incredibly valuable. It really is. So I think that's going to be the segue into the next bit, isn't it? Let's start talking about some of the ways that people can start doing machine learning.
Well, first of all, that's amazing, your testimony there. I think you're good at podcasts, but you might have missed your calling because that's a pretty impressive thing to do. I think I'd lose motivation and end up watching a documentary and falling asleep at the time that you got to your second iteration of your machine learning model. That's awesome. Okay, so the question is how people can start using. Would you like to talk about that in the context of this world of computer-aided engineering and our industry and simulation?
What I want is everybody who's listening to this podcast now or watching this podcast to go away and just start doing some of this stuff as well. So basically what I want to do is kind of break down some of those obstacles to entry and demonstrate to everybody that this is technology which is useful now. And with the generative AI, you know, you can get it to lead you through it as well. So you don't necessarily have to read loads of textbooks or search loads of websites. You can be up and running within an hour or two, I think.
Yeah. So my go-to recipe for that, for just how do I lower the barrier to entry and get involved? I'm a huge fan of Kaggle and a huge fan of Google Collab. And basically, you can use either for free compute. So as long as you have a computer that can access a web browser, then you can make a free account, get some limited amount of hours to run projects on either platform. And they even offer GPUs. So you're not limited to a very, very like slow, small data set problem. Like your experience with CNNs, you can use a GPU and start getting involved. And I love Kaggle in particular, not only so that I can constantly be humbled at the people who keep winning competitions and how I can't win them ever, but because also, you know, it's like the best place to learn hands-on. People publish their notebooks and publish basically their scores and how they got, like the code they used to get their scores whenever they try to do a project. The data is all available for open use, so you can completely log in for free, get access to a GPU, no setting up your environment, no setting up libraries and dependencies and anything. You get the data, you have discussion boards for popular competitions where people explain all the critical steps, and it's a vast space. So if you want to specialize in time series forecasting, you know, there's probably a dozen plus competitions there that have really fruitful content. So that's the best way to get hands-on. And then my full sort of spectrum of recommendations, if you really want to learn and invest time to build up what you can do in machine learning as a non-expert, is precede that exercise with hands-on with the machine learning specialization on Coursera. That's probably my favorite one, and probably one of the most popular ones by members or students or whatever. That gives you just kind of a sample of everything, I would say. And then the reality is after you do the hands-on bit, pick a lane, pick a area, it's pretty overwhelming, the advancements and how rapidly they happen in machine learning. So I think if you don't try to like specialize in one thing or spend a season of your life doing specific types of problems or specific types of models, you may remain kind of at the surface, which is fine if that's what you want. But, you know, people tend to probably gravitate towards certain subjects and then, you know, practice a bunch of competitions and tutorials and readings on like that little refined space. I mean, at a high level, that's kind of what I would recommend to get started. And it's very achievable. You know, obviously the most of who we talk to in our group at Sim Center is simulation and test products and experts, people with mechanical engineering backgrounds and aerospace backgrounds. And while the majority of our coursework for us does not involve any formal programming, Python's a great language to learn. And also, we've dealt with very complicated things, right? Like partial differential equations that have no solutions and numerical approaches that are the best way to approximate those. I mean, writing those codes is very, very complex. And there's plenty of empowerment that we should feel having spent time in that area to come into this and approach machine learning as stuff that's similar to regression, which we've heard before and we've learned before. And that'll be a segue when we show the hands-on bit. I'll show kind of the union of our maybe traditional regression experience to machine learning and how there's probably more overlap than we may realize.
And I think as engineers as well, we're used to using models, which can be hard to use, don't always work first time. Sometimes you have to kick them a few times before they produce anything useful. And so all those skills are useful for machine learning, as is the ability to work with large data sets as well. Because, you know, we've been in the big data game for as long as CFD's been around, for 30 years. And so we're used to dealing with data, cleaning data. And so those are all really helpful skills, because there's a lot of data cleaning involved in machine learning as well, as what I found.
Yeah. And the analysis tools we're used to look at our results from big studies or simulations, it's not that different than there's transferable knowledge there into machine learning on how we can analyze data. And a lot of that is done in the steps in the beginning of the process where you're analyzing your data to make it suitable for machine learning models. And we'll touch on that a bit in the hands-on bit that I'm super excited about for the second half of the podcast. But you're right. People should feel empowered.
Should we talk about that now then? Should we talk about the steps? You're going to take us through the steps you need to go through in a typical AI problem.
Yeah, sure. So the steps here are kind of like a flow diagram. There's a lot of different pieces to a certain block, you know, depending on your problem. You may have a classification problem or a regression problem. And the reality is obviously, you know, the prep work for either is different, right? But if you try to abstract to a very high level, you know, I basically have it to like six steps or five steps. And the first one is really problem definition. And this is so important because especially in the last 3 years when other industries started taking on machine learning and there was a learning curve, you know, a huge amount of time in meetings and SOWs and clarifications was on what data we have and what problem we want to solve. And that's really just about deciding on the business value and the business problem you're trying to answer. And in the case of, say, CFD simulation, you know, you could be saying, I want to make predictions for this sets of geometries, and I'm okay with the model having these limitations, because you can't take it and use it everywhere. So you kind of have to have like an iterative discussion about what data you'll have and what insights that would offer you later once you have the model. So the problem definition is the compromise on both of those, and then realizing, does that answer a business problem? Does that give me a return on investment to set up the model? And that problem definition step is key in the first step. Now, the second being data collection. So this one's not an extensive one to talk about until you get into the details of, well, sometimes it could be physical measurement data. Sometimes it could be simulation data, which could be images, CSV files, pictures. It could be all kinds of things, right? But in essence, you know, you just agreed upon the mandate and charter and sort of like vector of the problem and how you're going to solve it. You collect the respective data. And there's some analysis tools in there to just make sure that you've done what you hoped for and collected the right data. Now, I'll call it step three, A, B, and C, because it's very related in terms of you may have to cycle through these 3A, 3B, 3C, but they're separate steps. The first one would be data preparation. The analogy would be if I'm running let's go back to computational fluid dynamics problem. We're running a bunch of simulations, and the goal is really to ensure safety, right? And a good performance of the component that you're designing. So obviously you're going to notice outliers in terms of the performance, in terms of the geometry, in terms of the operating conditions that this part could experience. And you really want to run a study to cover all of that, right? So in the same way that you would want to have edge detection or outlier detection, or you'd make this decision on like, well, do I focus on the average behavior or do I focus on like the extreme behaviors? Or maybe it's an aircraft and you want to focus on the extreme behaviors because that's where you may have failure of some kind, right? So in the same way that you sort of judiciously decide how you're going to look at your data and samples and maybe excluding some or including some is also a very relevant step in machine learning pipelines for data preparation. Because the reality is, you know, you're going to fit a model and do you want it to capture the mean trends or where all the points are densely populated, or, you know, should you include the outliers or not? Those will have definite impacts on your results. And there's all kinds of things that fold into data preparation without being too long-winded. Maybe your data is highly skewed. Maybe the data you collected isn't ideal and you'd rather transform it or do those sorts of things that just kind of make the models better to digest the data, make better predictions. So, you know, you prep the data. As I said, it's kind of like a coupled step, like 3A, 3B, 3C. You know, you prep the data. You do some model training and you iteratively look at different models, different model hyperparameters or settings. And after that, you evaluate, right? People break their data sets down into chunks and they use some for training, some for testing, and some for at the end, when it's all said and done, how does it perform? And in this sense, you know, it may be iterative that you realize, oh, it didn't perform that well. So why? Oh, well, I didn't apply this sort of manipulation to my data, or I had missing values, or my data's causing some sort of other issue, let me tweak it. And then you again fit the models and then evaluate. So you kind of cyclically do that until you're happy, you know, make it as interpretable as possible. And then the last step is you deploy it, you use it, you take advantage of it, you know, you've made this thing, now go realize the value of it, whether you're using it as a reduced order model and you put it in a digital twin or an executable digital twin, or whether you're going to deploy it and have the model like managed over time in your internal system for when others call on it for predictions. So in that sense, you know, we'll get to recap, define the problem, collect the data, iteratively go through tweaking the data, training, and looking at the results. And then once you cycle through and you're happy with if you've satisfied your initial business objective problem definition, then you send it off and deploy it and manage it.
So in terms of effort, engineering effort, yeah, where do you have to concentrate your effort? What's kind of the hours split or the proportional split between those different stages? Is that easy to say or not? Or does it depend on the problem?
It's a dirty question because there's no one size fits all, but life is full of dirty questions, so it's a perfectly good one to ask. Most people would say that they spend not, I want to say the least amount of time, but probably not the most amount of time on picking different models to use for training and tweaking those models to be ideal in terms of optimizing the settings or the hyperparameters. Usually the other steps are more time consuming. So in a case where you have no data and you have to generate simulation results, that could be time consuming. Or maybe less or so if you have a bunch of data existing and you just have to spend time to ask different team members what the sampling was for those different sets of simulations they ran, collect them into one place, analyze them, stuff like that. But usually the beginning steps take more time than just simply training different models and looking at them.
So I guess that the time that you invest in 1, 2, and 3, yeah, or 3A, will pay you back double in 3B, 3C, and 4. I think that's the point, isn't it? Is that you need to put the upfront work in, making sure you're working with the proper data, rather than have to troubleshoot at the back end. So like when you're doing a CFD problem, yeah? If you don't build a good mesh, well, you can try and fix that by changing under relaxation parameters and try and deal with the errors downstream, but you're better off investing the time in building a good mesh. And I think it's probably true that you need to spend a lot of time on 1, 2, and 3 so you can pay off at the end of the process as well.
Yeah, that's a theorem that we all learned in school at some point, garbage in, garbage out. So it's no different to CFD model, to collecting physical test measurement data, to machine learning model fitting. But there is a nice thing here is that for a few years, it was all about big data, bigger models, bigger data sets that the models can digest. So just get a ton of data, fit it to a huge model. You know, it'll cost tens or hundreds of thousands of dollars to do this as far as the electricity bill, right? But definitely lately, however you want to call it, but maybe a year or two ago from the present time, there's been a huge shift to smaller models, smaller data. I think there's a big quote, like the era of big data is dead, right? Where it's all focusing on lesser data. So for us, that's nice because that means as pioneers in the field make more and more advanced models that can handle smaller amounts of data, maybe you need less data as far as the simulations you have to go off and run, right? So it may not be as intimidating as it may seem. And it certainly depends on the problem. Some problems don't need very much data. Some problems the data is cheap. Sometimes it's not. Sometimes it's a pain. It's expensive. It's big, clunky, right? But it's not always, right? But what about in your case? You know, you're a Kaggle grandmaster now. So give us some postmortem on that experience. I mean, where did you spend the most amount of your time?
So the Kaggle, doing the Kaggle data recognition thing, it was because the data set is a well-established data set. So I just had to download it and use it and train it. The first problem I started on, which is a kind of an engineering problem, but where I live, they've just changed the flight paths for aircraft. And so we have lots of airplanes flying over our house, making lots of noise. Yeah. And I've, you know, a friend of mine's got an aerial up and is recording, tracks all the airplanes. And we had 18 gigs of data for about a year of aircraft flying over it. And I thought, you know what, it would be fun to get that data for any given day and plot it on a graph so I can see, you know, which aircraft are going well. And so I did that. And you look at the sky above your house, yeah. And I live in a rural area, but there's hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of tracks going all over the place. And so I decided, how am I going to decide which of these airplanes are flying to Stansted or are flying to Heathrow, are flying to Luton? And so we can, you know, different airplanes at different heights. And if I tried to do that myself, I'd have to kind of look at the altitudes and look at where they were going. So what I decided to do was, firstly, I had to split up 18 gigs of data into usable chunks so I could read it into my model. And so basically I started off by working on one day's worth of data rather than trying to do it for, you know, a whole year's worth as well. But then I split it up. I read it in. I found a way of classifying some of the flights. So if you look at there's some databases of aircraft where you can go in and wrote an interface to an API. So I could track, you know, I look at the hex ID of an aircraft and work out where some of them were going to. And then I just drew a box in the sky. I worked. And for the ones that I knew, I trained a neural network, a simple neural network, which I think was like two layers, about 16 neurons, not a lot. It was really simple to look at the coordinates of where airplanes entered that box and the altitude of where they entered the box and where they left it. And from that, I could, with like 99% accuracy within a few hours, predict any aircraft flying over my house. And so this spaghetti map of all different aircraft suddenly turned into a color-coded map where I could see which aircraft were going in which direction, which for me, and again, I did this at 11 o'clock at night and didn't sleep because I was so excited all night that I've managed to solve this problem, which would have taken me months, if not years, to try and do it manually. And I did it in a few hours by just playing around with neural networks. And so, you know, I up until then, neural networks are things that other people had used, but using ChatGPT to say, I've got this problem, a classification problem, classic machine learning problem, how would I set up a simple neural network? And it just did, you know, it wrote the simple code for me and I fine tuned it in a few hours and it just really works. And then I applied that set to a year's worth of data and have published the maps everywhere. And it's been really useful for people as well. So that was my biggest challenge, but so the data preparation step for me and getting, so I'm more and more aware that most data is dirty in some way. And so cleaning up that data, splitting up, getting into a form that the neural network could find useful was the most difficult bit for me, but also, you know, most rewarding in terms of return on investment as well, because once you've done it, you can do lots of clever things.
That's cool. It's clear that we have successfully converted you to a machine learning soul. So
it's always
a pleasure to see your passion. But what's interesting is
the wormhole. It's an obsession. I blame you completely. You and Remy for this completely. Because Perfect. Before I talk to you, yeah, you know, the first two times I talked to you guys, I was talking to you guys as experts, and there was never any prospect that I was going to start doing this myself. And now, like, I spend most of my leisure time. I need to kind of dial it back a bit because it's getting too much. Because there's all these things, all these problems I wanted to solve, and I've had ideas in my head and I couldn't solve them. But all of a sudden, overnight, I can solve them all because I've got the programming skills through ChatGPT, and I've got some, you know, and I can tack machine learning onto them as well. And so, you know, I'm really evangelical in my love of machine learning and AI. So I thank you for that, Justin. It's a good thing and a bad thing.
Good. Now, it's always a pleasure to talk to a fellow nerd, and that's a cool testimony. But I'll just point out one thing that's interesting is, you're right? You didn't spend that much time researching the best model or doing more complicated manipulations or combinations of models to come up with the best answer. And you probably, if you took it to the next level, you'd spend more time on steps in the process that aren't related to model fitting, right? You'd probably say things like, okay, let me zoom out and look at the problem definition, right? And then certain things become very important, right? Like, okay, what percentage of airplanes that go through there are, you know, American Airlines passenger flights, real big ones, right? Probably the majority. Okay, well then how does your model fare when you have like a tiny corporate jet or a private plane, right? It could be a completely different sort of behavior that you miss because maybe only 1% of flights do that. So then you have to do these techniques. Like in that case, if you're running a classification problem, you know, what's called class imbalance. You have 99% of classes are these commercial passenger planes that anyone can book. And then 1% of them are like business jets for like six people. And so you have to zoom out and think about it at a high level, the business problem that you're trying to solve with machine learning. And then things like that become very important. And one reason I love having the blessing of a job that is focused on machine learning in CAE is, instead of me thinking about in my day-to-day work, passenger planes and versus business jets, right? I'm thinking about things I learned in grad school from physics and from engineering and thermodynamics and heat transfer and stuff. And so it's cool to be able to look at machine learning from a physics perspective and then try to ascertain if things are being conserved, if things are being, like, these core concepts and things we know from engineering are being preserved in the machine learning. And that's not always possible, but I mean, it's just a union of two fun things, right? So thanks for sharing your story. It's also illustrative towards the steps in the pipeline that people take when doing a machine learning exercise, I think.
So given that I've been successfully radicalized by you and Remy, so how I think you're going to show us your examples now and see if we can get some more people into the cult of machine learning.
Yeah, let's do it. Let's all do that. So what I'm going to show you first, just to say what it is, and then we won't talk about it again. This is a Siemens product called SimCenter Studio. It may look like a Jupyter notebook because essentially what you write in here is Python code just as if it was a Jupyter notebook. But there are distinct advantages here for using SimCenter Studio versus just regular Python. And that's in this case that it is tied to our other Siemens products, such as, for example, AIMSim for systems modeling. And in this case, you can actually orchestrate and control and kick off simulations as services through this client. And then you can access the data, do machine learning or Pythonic type things as the way to interact with the data. But it's more than just Python. But what I love about it, among other things, is I can just write Python code in it, right? So, and also, I don't have to install anything. It's cloud-based, at least how I'm using it. And I think most people use it that way. So I don't have to install anything. So in this case, we're going to go through a simple example. You know, throw the podcast on monitor one. And on monitor two, open up Google Collab, Python, Jupyter Notebook, Spider, whatever you want to use, or SimCenter Studio. I think we'll have a link shared and thrown up here. That way people can just click the link in order to go to learn more about SimCenter Studio and maybe get started. This is meant to be an example where you can access immediately. You don't have to request any data. The example is picked so that it can showcase some of the steps here I'm showing that I already talked about as far as the machine learning high-level abstracted steps in a pipeline. And then the data is not something private or that you even have to download. You can actually just import this data through sklearn library. So as with most cases, the first step is let's just import the necessary libraries. In this case, I'll hide it because it's not super interesting. And we don't want to make this podcast tedious every single step. But pandas, NumPy, etc. we'll go through in terms of importing libraries. Now, intaking the data is obviously important. That's one of the first steps here. So we're going to use this data set that I mentioned from SKLearn called the California Housing data set, which essentially has, once we import the data as a data frame, we can just print the columns. You can see things like income, the house age, average number of rooms, average bedrooms, things of that nature that describe demographics and socioeconomic things regarding the geographic location of the house. And essentially the goal of the data set here is to take these factors and then make a model so that you can predict the price. And in this case here, we can plot histograms of the different variables that I just mentioned. And you can maybe notice a few things, maybe not. I'll use you as the guinea pig, Stephen, because I love to pick on you. Does anything jump out at you in this data set when you look at it, or more or less no red flags?
Well, in terms of issues with it, that's a dirty question. We're talking about dirty questions as well. So clearly all of the properties are concentrated in a very specific geographical area, yeah, because the longitude and latitude is fixed as well. The average number of rooms as well is like, well, that scales a bit off, because of the average number of rooms, a property with 150 rooms, yeah, is kind of big, I would say, even by California standards. Yeah, so for a start, those things even need to be cleared up, or we need to focus on the relevant data, because that, you know, that looks like we're focusing on too big a range of things. In order training a model with 150 rooms when there's not many of them is going to be difficult as well. So those are the two things. There's also average occupancy is between, what does that even mean?
It's in the neighboring area, like density for people in occupancy near the house. But yeah, I think you have some great observations, and I didn't really even think about it because we're so friendly. I should have probably cleared this with you to give you a heads up on some pointers, but I didn't, and you picked up on the right things here. Some of the data looks good, like house age. You know, this has like a normal distribution or a Gaussian distribution, which looks more or less like what you want most of the time when you use a machine learning model to fit it. Some of these things just look a little bit silly, like no matter the model you fit, you know, why would you consider less than a fraction of a percent of cases where there's 150 rooms in the house? You know, the majority of the cases would be what, like under 50, under 20. I don't know how people live these days, but I don't have 50 rooms in my house, etc. So what we can do firstly is just look at the data that we've collected, right? So we can just compute some basic things. And again, this is meant to be like code along, but it don't be tedious and make it like an impossible podcast to follow because every single line I just robotically repeat, right? So, you know, reach out. We'll share the sheet with you if it's of interest. The data set is public. But at any rate, you know, one of the things we want to print is null values or missing values and just show a sum for each of these variables here. And you can see they're all zeros. So great. We don't have any blanks in the data that would cause the model to come back later and say, I can't fit data because of the size or this value is invalid, right? And then also, I love this command here. So our data set's called DF for data frame.
So a data frame, for people who are not familiar with pandas, it's like a spreadsheet, isn't it? They're like spreadsheets, and you can do the kind of row and column manipulation you can do in something like Excel, but you can do it inside Python. And I think my experience would be once you start using pandas, you'll use Excel a hell of a lot less because it's just so versatile and useful when you get used to it as well.
Yeah, it's meant for the machine learning community. It handles large data like tensors, would maybe a more familiar term for people who think about like stress tensors and stuff. And in this case, it's meant to be very vast and handle the data really well, allow you to do manipulations, things like that. So it's certainly a popular one. And what I love to do is just for quick feedback, quick information, you know, is this dot describe command here. And that's what prints below all the zeros here. And you can see that it's just printing statistical information to you. The mean, the standard deviation, the min, the max, and then these 25, 50, and 75% quartiles, which essentially just means if I have my full data and I divide it into four bins so that there's an equal number of points in each, what are those cutoff values for 25%, 50%, 75% of the data? And as we mentioned, this is useful because then we can detect things like outliers. So for example, and above with average rooms, right? I'm going to guess that the 75% or the upper limit of this bounding box of where all the data falls, it's going to show that 150 rooms or probably even 50 is an outlier. So we'll get to that later, but this is just an interesting way to get some information back fast. And also, you know, you can get a sense on if you've just collected the data improperly. Like if, you know, this is a problem for physics, we could say Reynolds number or RPM. You know, these can be some of our columns, and we could just check, okay, Reynolds number is 200K. That makes sense. It's not negative. RPM is something like 60 or 6,000 or something like this, right? Depending on the speed, you know, it's also not negative. It's also not millions, things like that. So it's good because a lot of the times you won't get perfect data the first time. Now we're going to do something controversial, but I promise you that it's justified. So for the machine learning pipeline, we are going to use a linear regression model. So before you throw your hands up and say that's not machine learning, you may be right, depending on the philosophical context that you want to answer that question with. But we've touted the name Kaggle a bunch. And one thing that they're really good at also is providing yearly surveys for data science and machine learning. And this was from 2021. So you can expect that transformers and GPT models will be much, much higher for 2023. But essentially, this figure I grabbed from it was, what are the models that are used by people in industry the most for their machine learning studies? And wouldn't you know it, linear's at the top, so you can't be up in arms against me for doing it in this case, because this is exactly the context that people use it in. I just want a quick and dirty answer, and I want it to be fast, and I want to be able to interpret it, right? Linear models, much more interpretable than a black box machine learning model. And in this case, it's still useful, right? Like our human minds, you know, in school, we know what a 2D thing looks like, X versus Y. We know what a 3D thing looks like, X, Y, Z. We can visualize the space for data points populated in 3D. But what about 4D, 5D, 10D, right? I mean, in this case, we have seven variables, right? I mean, I can't imagine what a seven variable space looks like. But in this case, maybe a linear model would still be okay at advancing what we understand from our data just by fitting a linear model to it, right? So in this case, just to start, we'll do linear, and then later we'll do others. And of course, if you wanted to make this more formal and serious effort, you would immediately abandon something that can capture nonlinear relationships. But
I also think it's useful in engineering as in all fields as well, is you want to use the simplest model that's going to give you a good answer, aren't you? You don't want to dive straight in at the deep end to something with lots of parameters you have to tune in. Just understanding the problem in a linear perspective at the start is a good first step as well, often.
Yeah, and I think something that you probably pick up after a few number of models is, at least if you have to mesh a model and make a discretized domain in CAD, in your simulation from CAD, typically, if you're worried about it not converging or solving correctly, you would run a very coarse, simple mesh. That way you can keep fixing all the errors in the mesh and then run the big meshes that take like an hour to generate, right? Like, why would I fix 10 easy small things and every time make it mesh for an hour when it can mesh for 5 minutes, right? So in this case, it's almost similar. And in this case, we'll start out with just a simple command here to generate the training and testing data sets and build and train the linear model and make predictions on the testing data set. I'll not pick on you. I'll just say a lot of people would maybe even fumble if you say the difference between training, testing, and validation. So I can clarify that real quick here in a figure that I think covers it nicely. You know, when we fit a model and we do this training process to iteratively converge on the best weights and biases and settings or degrees of freedom, whatever general term you want to use to describe, you know, how you set up a machine learning model in training, you will use the training data, right? A subset of the full data set will be training. Usually it's the most, 70%, something of that nature. And then in that case, you will evaluate the model on what I call, and I think the terminology is different, but I call it validation data. And then from that, you would get a sense on how accurate the model is, and then you would change and improve the model. And you do this cycle over and over and over again, try different models, try different hyperparameters, and eventually say, this is the best model. Okay, well, that's great. But since you're going to go use that model on data you don't have in real life, right, then it's probably good if you also have a separate data set held blind to the side to evaluate it on before you go do that. And that is what I like to call the test data. So in this case, it wasn't used during the process of setting up the model, so it's not biased. But nevertheless, you know, if I have 100 units of data, maybe 70 would be train, maybe 20 would be validation, and 10 would be test. And the best reason why I can say people probably get this confused is the languaging here, depending on what machine learning library you use. You see that I'm splitting this into training and testing, but this is really what I just called training and validation. So stick to your terminology, whatever. Just understand the concept of how you need to break it into different pieces for different reasons.
An important point here is, though, is it's doing the splitting for you as well, isn't it? You're saying I want 20% of the data be for test data or your validation data in your language. So you don't have to worry too much about physically splitting data yourself. The algorithm will do it for you randomly as well.
Yeah, and you can do it. It depends kind of on the problem and how serious you are about it. In this case, I'm using just a random split. I'm specifying the percentage, and I'm choosing random states so that basically the results be predictable every time. It's not deterministic, so I kind of have to assign something so that every time I train and split with random state 42, I get the same cases showing up in train, test, validate, etc. But, you know, if I have some knowledge of my problem, like flow over a flat plate, and I know I have some laminar cases, some transitional, some turbulent, I need to think ahead and think, well, how am I going to use the model when it's done? Is it only going to be used in turbulent cases? Am I going to have a mixture? Is the majority of when I use the model going to be on inferences for cases that are laminar? And that is great knowledge and thought process to have when you split up your data ahead of time to say, well, if I'm going to use it for mostly laminar cases, then it would not make sense if my test set was completely turbulent, right? There should be some mixture representative of how I want to use the model. So anyway, to end my long-winded thing here, we'll make some metrics like mean squared error and R squared. And in this case, when you run the model, you see, oh gosh, R squared is only 0.575. Not great, right? But I mean, hey, it's a linear model. What can you expect? Yeah, it gives me some confidence that maybe I didn't completely jumble what data I'm using. Maybe I did use the right data, but it's just not a good fit, right? And in this case, you know, okay, why? Let's, as far as this coupled 3A, 3B, 3C steps, like, okay, why is, that's just a single metric, a single number. It doesn't describe why. So I can use plenty of things here, and I'm just choosing to simply show this plot, which shows the predicted prices versus the actual prices. So predicted versus actual, what the model predicted versus the actual answer. And in this case, you can see that it should follow a one-to-one line that's indicating that exactly the right value was predicted. Any deviation from that means that the answer is wrong. Further deviation from the line means bigger oops. And what you can see here immediately is for prices that are at the max range here, there's this giant vertical line that looks terrible, right? So maybe we could say that this is just introducing error for like an artificial way and not a meaningful way. We have error here. And maybe one step is we could clip and filter all data above 4.99, right? And then in that case, we can look at a more reasonable thing. But in general, hard to take away too much from this within a 5-second sort of glance. But to me, I can sort of see that it's a flat line. It's not following it probably with enough slope. But either way, I want to turn your attention back to what we talked about in the beginning. You know, this distribution is normal slash Gaussian, however you want to describe it, which is a good thing for machine learning models. And in this case, we have a huge peak. That's not very good. We'd love to spread this out to to a more normal distribution. So we can use transforms. We can just make a logarithmic translation of, say, average rooms. You know, we can turn that into, well, that is actually the logarithmic value of average rooms equals average rooms. So in that case, when we do that, we can see that now it's starting to look better. Right now you can see this is not quite as good looking as house age, right? But it's certainly not one piled up huge thing. And furthermore, at the same time, what I didn't mention yet is that I'm also applying a normalization, a scaling, if you want to call it that. So now all the values are between 0 and 1. And that's also good too, because not every type of machine learning model, but a fair majority of the popular ones do have a difference in terms of a bias in a bad way. If I have one thing like Reynolds number, that could be 500,000. And then another parameter as an input like diameter, that could be 0.05, right? So that the sheer difference in size can bias machine learning models sometimes. So this is a fairly common thing to do as well as to normalize. So to recap, we did a log transform on all the data, and we also just scaled it with a min and max. So all the income, median income things here, took the min, took the max, scaled so that they all fall between 0 and 1. And when we apply this, we can also say, well, what if we remove those nasty outliers, right? You know, like we mentioned in that case of average bedrooms here, what if we remove everything that's normalized, you know, in this value range of 0 to 1, so that everything above 0.17 is just scrapped, right? We want to remove the outliers. I think we mentioned that early on, that some of these cases like average rooms, obviously we want to remove 150, probably even 50. We can follow rules like remove 1% of the data at the most extreme, etc. And you can see that when we do these very simple things, our accuracy jumps up quite a bit. With the scaling, we get to 66.667 in terms of the R squared, meaning when we apply the normalization of the log transform. And then when we go a step further and we say, well, let's also remove those outliers. And that's why I jumbled the values, right? As we've taken the log transform, we've normalized it. Now 150 bedrooms is probably like 0.2 or something. So sorry about that. But the point is, I think you can see we're taking all the variables that have very, very small values and very, very large values and removing them. And it's probably equivalent to about 1% of the data we're taking away. And simply from that, now our R squared is 0.697. So basically 0.7. So all we've done is just look at the data, apply some things that we probably learned from Statistics 101 in college, fitting some models and any data-driven exercises we've done in our simulation work, and we've jumped the accuracy, you know, whatever that is, like 0.15, which is great. People spend a ton of time breaking their backs to go up 0.02, right, at the very end of their projects. So this is certainly a meaningful thing to do here.
It's an iterative process, isn't it? And it's almost good that you had your first naive prediction wasn't quite what you expected, because that gives you the impetus to look at your data some more, because you've already looked at your data in the first place, but to go through, correct a few things and get better results as well. So it's always an iterative process, and you're always kind of tuning these models. I mean, with linear regression, it's obvious what you're doing. When you get to more complicated models like neural nets, sometimes it's a bit of a kind of, it's more of an art than a science sometimes, and you're tuning parameters, as is numerical simulation often as well. You're tuning parameters and kind of hoping to get a better output. But yeah, so it's always going to be an iterative process, I think, is my point.
Right. Yeah. I mean, think about like a heat transfer on a flat plate. Like, I'll just stick to fluid and thermal and CFD. I mean, if you have flow over a flat plate and you have a critical sort of Reynolds number, you know, you can see your heat transfer values dip and then spike back up whenever there's transitional flow, and then, you know, go on their way when they're turbulent. So in this case, I mean, if we're trying to fit a linear model to something like heat transfer versus distance along the plate, right? I mean, we know kind of what it's going to do, how it's going to try and find the middle and just make a slope that matches both. And we know that data points that fall off of that will be extreme lows at the end of the laminar, extreme highs when it's transitional. So we can physically understand why our model did what it did and why those points aren't matching very well and have very high error. Okay, well, if we do the same with a neural network, I mean, we don't really get that same level of confidence when we look at the predictions and understand why they're off, right? So it is going to behoove us to start with really simple stuff, and then just once we max it out, keep going, and then do things like upgrade to a neural network. And that's what we'll show in the next few cells of the notebook. So this stuff is just for fun, because, I mean, with the field rapidly evolving and people doing so much to contribute, it just makes our lives more and more fun to use these tools, right? So in this case, I really like to mess around with this library called Lazy Predict. It's exactly, in this case, what we want to call it. I just want to try out a bunch of models in sort of like a broad net. And then I would love to just see how they fare, right? Maybe we don't trust them indefinitely what the results are, because it is going to be a quick shot. But then we can at least have a sense on what models are probably the best ones to look at. And then we can deep dive on them. And so when we do that and simply print the results here, you can see our poor little linear regression here at the vicinity and neighborhood that we talked about, 0.62. I don't know if it's applying those transforms or not, right? But it is in the vicinity here. And what we can see is if we go up, we see other models that would be the usual suspects, decision trees, random forests are really high. So it's fun because in this case, you can look at the time taken to fit the model and it's peanuts. Even on a CPU for this data, maybe a minute, and then it would complete the calculation and spit all this information.
I want to use bagging regressor because it's got the coolest name. I mean, what's a bagging regressor? Nobody knows. You might know.
So I like things like what stands out to me are things like lasso, ridge CV, and then the fact that a lot of these are tree-based methods. So in this case, the first ones I mentioned are for regularization. So basically, these are approaches that are kind of irrespective to the model you pick, but they penalize you if they realize they're set up in such a way to avoid overfitting. And so they kind of tuned and changed the way that the model's trained so that there's less overfitting. And in case you don't know, less overfitting means there's a really great meme where someone's lying in a bed and they, you know, they're like me, they lay on their side and they kind of like tuck their knees in a bit. So the problem would be design an ideal bed. Well, if I laid in the bed, someone could just trace my contour, cut that out and say, that's the perfect shape for a bed, right? Well, that's overfit because that's overly specified to just me if I'm one data point. Give it to Steven and he may sleep like, I don't know, he's having a revelation or something. And then it would be a completely inappropriate fit, right? So this process of regularization is preventing overfitting so that it's going to do well with more confidence on more general diverse sets of data that you could want to feed it.
So I was going to say that list could be quite intimidating, couldn't it? Because you've got all these different approaches. It's giving you an indication about which ones are best. But for me, the next natural step is to take some of those models, some of the best performing one. I'd be jumping straight into ChatGPT-4 with the prompt and saying, look, tell me what the difference is between bagging regressor and some of the other models as well. And I mean, so one way that might not work is that ChatGPT is only trained from a couple of years ago back, isn't it? So some of the more recent models might be in there. But in terms of getting a quick description about what these things are, what they do, and how they're linked is something you can do quite easily these days as well.
Yeah, and you can keep it simple, right? I mean, again, this is meant to be quick and dirty, so the devil's in the details. Maybe some of it's misleading on problems. Absolutely, you should do diligence. But I mean, we could do this super fast and get some insights and then move on, right? That's a good use of our time. And you can say like really concrete, simple things. Like I see linear regression here, and then I see MLP regressor, right? A multi-layer perception, right? That's only 0.65 for a neural network and linear's 0.62. I mean, come on. If I upgrade to this random forest method, right? I'm 0.81. That's a much bigger shift and tells me maybe just focus on tree-based methods, right? So just very simple things to take away. And then before we take another eternity to go through all this, let's get to the last step here, which is just kind of a nod to the fact that this is a generative AI sort of theme in this podcast. And again, this goes to how flexible ecosystems is, the paradigm of using software. We can just simply import OpenAI library and use very, very basic code to take those ChatGPT models and then put them here. And then we can ask things, you know, on our data that we want, like, what analysis should I do on my data before fitting a machine learning model? You know, and in this case, maybe I didn't, you know, maybe I was too cheap and used a really old DaVinci model, I think is what this one's called, which is kind of an old one. But, you know, it's giving me this information in a useful way, right? It's difficult to answer, blah, blah, blah. But general things to consider is the type of data that you have, the distributions, which we touched on, the relationships of features and the target variable, what we're trying to predict. We didn't talk about that one. But the presence of outliers as well, and the dimensionality of the data. So, you know, not a terrible sort of response here to just conversationally ask stuff and have it built into our notebook and talk to us, right? And we can adjust these things, right? We can adjust the temperature, the top P. This will control the randomness of our model, sort of maybe give us more consistent answers that are more vanilla, but helpful and sort of like making sense. And we can go further and say, well, what is the purpose of a logarithmic transform in a machine learning study? And it does an okay job saying it's better and easier for the model to find patterns and relationships in the data. And yes, that's not, you know, that's not a very insightful thing as someone who already knew that, right? But I mean, it's directionally very helpful if you're trying to be a cyborg, right? If you're trying to break into data science, try out some things and you just have basic questions, right?
Yeah, it's a bit ChatGPT-3, but GPT-4 would give you better answers in general, wouldn't it? I think the fact we can recognize the level of output from the large language model shows you how quickly they're developing as well.
Exactly. And really, I mean, this is just for fun to show something, right? There's so much more. There's libraries now where I can actually call on the data that I have and then use a built-in language model to say, can you please tell me what transform would be ideal for my data? I mean, if you go to open up your web browser and go to ChatGPT, you can't do that, right? I mean, this is a different way to interact with our data. And I think that ties us back to, well, what is generative AI for engineering? And I think the future is closer and closer now where we can have an expert that's been 20 years at our aerospace company and distill their conclusions and insights and steps and best practices on how they would interpret and set up and interpret their simulation results, maybe access through a language model, right? That is a purely generative AI sort of capability and is very, very useful to expedite time and just continue to extend the advancements into like different applications and different companies. And I think it's just so exciting to be on the side of the commercial software provider to help be involved in that. Because I think it already is making an impact and it's just going to continue to be more exciting.
It always is, and I think everybody needs to be trying this today. I really do. So having this example is really helpful. All the code that you have there might seem complicated, but if I was doing this, I would be sitting with a ChatGPT prompt open next to me, asking it how to write the different bits of code. Sometimes, you know, altering that code myself, pasting it back in, and I'd be writing the code with ChatGPT as well. So you don't even have to be a Python expert because you can use AI to help you write AI.
Yeah, I mean, it reduces the barrier to entry. That's not a bad thing to do to get started for sure.
And then once you've got the models, you can spend as much time as you like twiddling parameters, looking at other models and looking for better fits. And so, yeah, it just takes the intimidation level down as if you can get started quickly and easily and you have something you can play with. So that's a really excellent example. Can you tell us a bit more about Sim Center Studio and how people can get access to that?
Yeah, so we'll provide a link. I think it's to the Sim Center Studio landing page, so you can get in contact with the group. I'm sure people will be motivated to give you a taste and a sort of tutorial and to try it out. It's one of my favorite tools when it first came out, which was, I don't want to give a timeline, but it's one of the more recent products in our portfolio. But I remember when it first came out, I had some resistance. I was very tethered to Python, Google Cloud, Spider, etc. And the product manager was like, look, what are you doing? Like, just use Sim Center Studio. It's going to be like, it's the same thing. Just use that. So yeah, I would encourage you to take the same advice. It's the same in that you can write Python, right? But you know, it's very powerful to have an organization to work with all, to kick off all your simulation runs, to grab the data, to analyze them, to build like a machine learning model setup. And then also there's a ton of features inside of it that are layers on top to save you time. It's a really powerful tool for generative engineering specifically. Because one sort of use case for Studio is that it should work with like a system simulation tool like AIMSIM. So the example I give is like maybe you're designing a drone and you're so early in the design stage that you're looking at the architecture of how the design should be. So everything's on the table. Gas powered, battery powered, long range, short range, vertical takeoff landing, not vertical takeoff landing. I mean, it's every kind of option is really more or less on the table. I mean, how do you cope with that many permutations of all the designs possible? I'm used to, as a CFD person, having like 99% of the design constrained and then being able to change very small things. And I just run CFD simulations on those very small things. But even in my case, right, I can do a sample, a DOE study, and still have 1,000 simulations to run and think, wow, that's too many. Well, in the case of systems, early on in the design process, I mean, it could be orders of magnitude more simulations that you would have to run in order to consider all of those options. So there's a lot of machine learning capabilities and a lot of smarts cooked in the studio to allow you to run the simulations in an optimized, sort of orchestrated way, hands off, governed like behind the scenes, and then basically also allowing you to explore the results in a really smart way, not like you're just wading through endless amounts of data, right? There's a lot of post-processing built into this where here, SCS Discover. And there are a lot of these tools as well for quality of life. So yeah, I don't want to deduce it down to just Python, but the other sense of if you just want to do something in Python, you could easily use Studio for it.
I want this to be a two-way conversation as well, not just me and you. So you're a bit of a guru on LinkedIn, and so we're going to be posting this podcast and the video on LinkedIn. But I'd be really interested to hear how other people are starting to use machine learning as well. I get it that it's early days. So I was in Germany a couple of weeks ago interviewing. I spoke to 20 or 30 engineers about what they're doing today. And if you went to the big presentation sessions at the conference, you wouldn't see much machine learning and AI because it's still people are still dabbling with it, you know, in lots of ways. But if you have private conversations with people, almost everybody I talk to, I was going to ask them about AI, but they dropped it into the conversation because everybody's starting to explore and experiment. And I think there's use cases. I think we can all learn from each other what some of the use cases are for this, because it's so early and so young and so new that there's so many different ways that we can apply this to our simulation processes, to our data processing as well. So it'll be really interesting if people drop us a line on kind of LinkedIn messages on the posts and tell us how they're doing some of these things, because that perhaps might inspire us for the next podcast as well to see some of the other things we can talk about as well.
Yeah, great point. And I think we should think of a way to incentivize that. Maybe if you leave a comment, you get the data in the notebook and something else or something of this nature. So if you're listening, jump on it and we'll make sure that it's worth your while other than just a nice discussion. And then also to give us the feedback to discuss and expand upon what you want to know more about. So I would support that.
Yeah, if anybody's got any public data sets that they're working on and, you know, they want to crowdsource communities advice onto, I think your LinkedIn page is a place where lots of people are interested to congregate as well. So that might be a useful way for people to get some insight and to kind of crowdsource some support as well. So, all right, I think that's a really interesting explanation. I hope we've demystified some of it as well. And I think we should probably schedule a follow-up session where we talk about some more engineering-specific data in the future.
Sounds good to me. Yeah, hopefully it was demystified a bit. And like we said before, you know, the barrier to entry hopefully is lowered just a little bit.
Yeah. All right. Thank you very much, Justin. And thank you very much for everybody's listening to the Engineer Innovation Podcast.
This episode of the Engineer Innovation Podcast is powered by SimCenter. Turn product complexity into a competitive advantage with SimCenter solutions that empower your engineering teams to push the boundaries, solve the toughest problems, and bring innovations to market faster.